हेलो अनिता दी।
हेलो हेलो रजत।
सो अ वेरी वेल वार्म वेलकम टू अनिता अग्निहोत्री, एमिनेंट ऑथर फॉर दिस वीडियो कैप्सूल विथ नियोगी बुक्स। नियोगी बुक्स रिसेंटली रिलीज्ड हर ट्रांसलेटेड कलेक्शन अ डे इन द लाइफ ऑफ मंगल तरम, ट्रांसलेटेड बाय द एमिनेंट ट्रांसलेटर रानी रॉय, हु इज एन एकेडमिक novelist, short story writer and poet. Anita Agnihotri hardly requires any introduction, but still it's my honor and privilege to introduce her to you. So what I will do is I will just read her bio from the back cover of her new book. Anita Di, can you just show us your new book which has been published by Niyogi? So yeah, as you can see, this is a day in the life of Mangal Taram, a collection of short stories by Anita Agnihotri, translated by Rani Roy. Please get a copy. It's available on Amazon and all your close by bookshops, neighborhood bookshops. So Anita Agnihotri's literary career spans many genres: poetry, novel writing, children's literature, and she has also written nonfiction, critics of development. But short story is the genre that stimulates her creative vein the most. She has authored over 30 volumes by now and has received several awards, including the Bongiya Sahitya Parishad Felicitation, Sharad Puraskar, Pratibha Basu Sahitya Puraskar, and the Bhuvan Mohini Dashi Gold Medal from University of Calcutta. She returned the Bangla Academy Literary Award in protest over the killing of innocents in Nandigram, West Bengal. Anita's writing explores the vast and complex Indian reality, many facets of human relations, and brings out the unheard voices of the marginalized and the underprivileged. And she has been translated into several languages, including English, German, and Swedish. So that is Anita Agnihotri for you. I will briefly introduce you the book and move on to the questions. I know there are many questions. Some viewers have already sent us questions. And anyone who wants to ask the author any question, you can just put it, type it out into your comments. So A Day in the Life of Mangal Taram is a collection of about 14 stories. And these are varied stories, some based in Odisha, some in Chhattisgarh, a few in Bengal, Calcutta. And very interesting characters. There's a Portchitra worker watching the world around him change. There's a story of a cyclone which is affecting impoverished people of Odisha. There is a very interesting story about mother-son dynamics and how the mother cannot ride because the son is away. There's a story about a couple visiting the battlefield of Palachi in Murshidabad, and how they just see how this place has changed over the two centuries from the Battle of Palasi. There's this very interesting eponymous story of a forest beat officer who is keeping record of nature while he is himself getting ensnared. He is himself getting ensnared by all the corruption around him. That is the story of Mangal Taram, the eponymous story of the book. So this is a rich and variegated collection of powerful and very compelling stories. So Anita Di, the first question I wanted to ask you is, when were these stories written? It seems that they were written over a long period of time because there are several contexts.
Yes, actually, thank you very much for the introduction. Collection which of whatever I have written over a span of, let us say, 35 years or so. So that is the first kind of collection. So there is a story called Fruits of Bhagwan, with 19. The story of Mangal Taram is very recent, it is written just a few years back.
Okay.
So we have got to give a flavor of all kinds of tales and
there's a bit of a network issue. We are having a little blurred video, but yeah, I could hear you. So Anita ji, if our viewers cannot hear, Anita ji is saying that the stories were written over a long period of time and the best have been chosen from our extensive over. At least the stories span about 25 years. That's what she's saying. There's a slight issue with the network, but we are with you. We'll continue with this. Let me move on to my first question, a substantive question. I will begin by reading one sentence, just a sentence from one of the stories. Anita ji, can you hear me? Am I audible?
Yes, but Bombay is heavy rain.
Okay, yeah, we have rain in Calcutta also, and Trisha is saying that the video is very choppy. Yeah. So,
is it better when you hold the phone in my hand? Is it any better?
Can you see? But then the video will go, I think. Yeah, now it's better. Trisha, yeah. can you hear us clearly now?
Trisha is saying she can't hear, it's quite choppy.
Yeah, that's what.
Maybe you can just go ahead with the question.
Yeah. So, the voice is also a problem? Mm-hmm.
Shall I change the place?
But
is it better this way?
Oh, she says it's better. It's better now. So let's just, yeah, go ahead. So I'm just reading one sentence from your story, Mela Ground, Fair Ground. It begins like this. The sky, a glittering blue, has descended on an autumn art like some glass bowl. A yellow sun brims over the four corners of the earth. What a beautiful smell there is in this forest-covered mountain land. The fragrance of earth bathed in dew, his father would have said, had he been around. So many of your stories begin with this beautiful evocation of nature, and the reader is mesmerized, and he or she is immediately pulled into the story, and actually there is no escape from him. He has to go on reading, and then you do several other things, weaving time through your story. The past, present and future all coexist in a timeless moment in each of your stories. So I wanted to ask you, was your experience, you have been an administrator, and I know you have been posted in Odisha, Chhattisgarh and other places, many of these forested areas, beautiful forested areas of these places. So has your role as an administrator helped you understand and write about nature? And also, were you pained by the contradictions that the people who belong to these places have to live lives of such hardship? So if you can just...
Brother, this is thank you very much. As an author, you have read my, it's very flattering that you have read my stories with so much of attention. Thank you so much.
Everyone reads your stories. Okay.
But first of all, let me tell you that my, you know, awareness about nature, my involvement started early in childhood, because as you know, all of us have been brought up on literature of Rabindranath Tagore, his short stories, Vibhushan Bandyopadhyay, for example, and this and Jivananda Das in poetry. So this basically sensitized me. Unfortunately, I used to stay in a city in a flat where even to see a sunset, I had to see the, you know, get the door of the terrace open with a special request where I could see and watch the sunset. But when I came to Bihar, that time, Jharkhand was not a separate state. But that wonderful highlands and the hills and the flowing rivers, everyone mesmerized me. I realized that I have been liberated from the city. I went over to landscape. But landscape has never been something which is, you know, isolated. It's always been the backdrop of my life. And I must tell you that in several of my stories and my novels in particular, Mohol Dihar Dain and Mahanadi that I wrote, this thing has come back. Like, nature is beautiful. It gives solace to people, it gives shelter to people, especially tribal people. They are totally dependent on the forest for their livelihood. But we have not been able to understand. We have not been able to understand or communicate with them. And our acts have been such that they have gradually got isolated from their main source of dependence, the forest. That has, you know, unempowered them, that has isolated them. So it's a huge tragedy, which was there with the British, and this has partly continued even in the future. So this has been captured, and as a result, I think I got a better understanding of what is going on in the field, because I was a part of the civil service. But then I could not help it. when, and it came out in my stories.
Yeah, I was listening to one of your earlier interviews where you said that being in the civil service and writing about these things is sometimes problematic, but many of these things also go under the radar of the government because the government is always not aware what you're writing. They don't read books. Many of them don't read books. So anyway, let me come to the endings of your story because the endings are also so beautiful. I have many of the endings are so captivating. They're memorable, poignant, or what else should I say? In fact, some of the endings of the stories in this book left me in tears. So let me ask you, Anita Dee, tell us, how do you craft such poignant, beautiful, memorable endings? Do they come naturally, or you have to do a lot of editing after writing? Do you write one shot, or do you do many edits?
No, in fact, Dr. Rani Roy, who translated me, she sometimes used to jokingly tell me, you know, I don't write anything twice. Even my novels are written in one go. All stories are written in one go, and I don't craft stories. That has been a weakness, you can say, as a writer, because I do not know whether I have been able to be fair to the reader all the time. But the growth is organic. I don't plan a story. It just starts in a flash, maybe with a, you know, view, some memory, or a building, or somebody's face, a street, and it goes on. Sometimes the end of the story has taken me, you know, beyond what I thought about when it started. In a very different direction. It happened in several stories. But something happens in the end, you know. When the story ends, I somehow feel a lot of things are coming, snapping, coming out of me, and there is a huge deluge of emotions, deluge of things, you know, you can say unhappiness or regret or just even love or a feeling of deep affection towards life. And then I snapped. You know, there are so many times while writing my own story, end of my story, I myself wept. I say in Bengali that my writing has often been washed in my own tears. So I'm very happy that you asked me this question. I want to share this with the audience today.
Yeah, we have many people have joined. I can see Niharul Islam, who is a noted short story writer from Murshidabad, and he also writes novels. He has a question for you, actually. He has sent it in Bengali. I will try to translate it for you. He's saying that the tradition of river novels in Bengali is quite strong. There are so many novels about rivers, like Padmanabhi Maji, Titash, and etc. So, and he's saying that your Mahanadi is a great addition to this school of writing, and how you have kind of depicted the characters of the people who live by the side of this river, and also the life of the river, and how this flows together. And this novel has taken us on a journey along with these people of the river and the river itself. So his question is, how do you create such a wonderful book? Ei ashchorjo srishtir utso.
Thank you. I'm honored, Niharulji, that you asked this question. In fact, it has been a big journey for me also. The river Mahanadi had captured my attention for over a decade. I have been thinking of writing. You know, it's a great river. It just started from Chhattisgarh, flowed through northern Odisha, then come to Bay of Bengal. But I could just get the courage, because writing not only of the river, but the people who have come and settled on both sides of the river, it has been a huge challenge. I have gone back many times to the catchment area, spoken to the people, lived their lives again. And finally, I could write. And I don't know, I mean, after writing this, I felt that even for me, like the river joining the sea, I have commenced a great literary journey myself. But river and landscape has been a tremendous influence on my creative thinking as well. And I'm very indebted to this state, Odisha and Chota Nagpur, that is Jharkhand, where I worked, because the richness of the natural beauty and the people who are so intricately dependent on nature, these have been a very important influence on me as a writer.
Okay. So Trisha is telling us that Niyogi is going to publish the translated Mahanadi very soon. I think the book is almost ready now. So that's a great news for us and for readers. So let us move to another question. This is about the nature content of your writing. All your novels, many of your stories, in fact, and your novels are based in the beautiful country south of Bengal, like Odisha and Chhattisgarh, basically the Chotanagpur Plateau. And this region for you is like very much like Rajmahal Hills and Bhagalpur was for Vibhuti Bhushan, or Sundarbans is for Amitav Ghosh. Like every writer has this place where they return to in their books. Amitav Ghosh has returned twice to Sundarbans, so, and Vibhuti Bhushan, Rajmahal Hills, and that area. So in your nature writing, we often find it's human beings interacting with nature, and then power and politics and several other things coming into the play too. But do you, in certain, some of your stories also give nature a kind of agency where nature is a very major actor in the plot, and it turns the story around? It has an effect on the destiny of the plot and the destiny of the characters very clearly, which would be a departure from a pure eco-fiction kind of writing where it's only nature and human beings interacting with it. But here I'm asking you whether there are certain plot elements, sometimes hidden, sometimes very prominent, where nature has a very clear agency and it's working through the plot. Have you written stories like that, or are there hidden elements of that in your stories which readers might want to know? Especially academic readers would be interested.
Yes, I think nature in my writing is powerful in the sense that, as I told you before, it not only offers solace or shelter to people, it basically moves with them. And you can see, you know, when you read Mangal Taram, the story in Bengali, it has been written in Shadu Bengali in order to convey the fierce and the grave nature of the forest. So they are almost, you can see, it is surrounding Mangal Taram. It is with him. You know, it is not with the people who are conspiring and corrupt. And I remember a story of mine called Sabotaj, where it has got, mixed. There is a complete overlap in such a way. A very, very tragic story in the sense, a young police officer who tried to understand people ultimately gets killed. But, you know, in the end, the forest has stopped somewhere a little near his, khidki darja, back door of his house. And when the moment of his being killed has not been shown, he only says the story in the end, and the forest just comes forward.
That's very interesting.
So I thought, the forest means the people, they have not been understood, and what goes on behind the scenes, you don't know. There is a tragedy, great human tragedy on both sides. So it will happen in Mahanadi, I would say, is a novel where the river actually transports the, characters. It keeps on moving. It has not followed the form of typical novel text. Like, it's like a, circular motion of a moving object. If the river keeps on moving, people keep on moving with that. And I would say that river, if not a character, it has become a very important force in the entire novel.
Okay, we have another viewer question. Suchorita is asking, among the many forms that you write in, poetry, short story, novel, which is closest to your heart?
It varies. Like, yes, short stories are very close to my heart. But after Suchorita, I became very fond of writing novels too. Because the second volume, After Lude of Mahanadi is coming out, Mahakantar, which is again a important journey of the river Indravati from Kalahandi to Gadchiroli in Maharashtra, and the story of the forest which was there, which is not there. But I would say that poetry and short stories and novels all three are close to my heart in that sense.
Okay, yeah. So I have two more questions, but we are almost out of time now. But let me ask you this. In Boundless, in the story Boundless, about the mother and son, you have written that when young, she was peeved watching Satyajit's Aparajito. She thought that Karuna could not capture Vibhuti Bhushan's Sarvojaya. So were you yourself peeved watching Satyajit's Aparajito for the first time because of this?
Yes. I think it is very much me speaking, to this story. And I used to feel very, very disturbed at heart that how can it be?
But, and how can she keep silent? Yeah.
life is life. It's so so many things are unspoken. When you come close to your near ones, you can't express. Just not possible.
Very true. Very true. Yeah. So I have one final question. There are more questions coming in, but we are almost out of time. We had some problem with audio in the beginning. I had a question about this thing I've noticed in many of your stories is you bring in myths, religious or otherwise, near the last scene, near the climax of the story. Like in the story about Sundar Potua, you have this Navagunjar pot that he had drawn, and it's described in detail, this chimeric form of Vishnu he has drawn on the pot. Or there is this story about this failed writer where this image of Durga's immersion is evoked near the end, and that gives the story a different kind of significance. Now, you know, the modernist writers like Joyce and Yeats and T.S. Eliot, they all use something called this mythic method, where myths were brought into storytelling or writing or poetry to give a different kind of significance to the commonplace, to what is happening in the plot or in the poetry. So do you consciously follow those modernists, or it just comes to you naturally that in many of your final scenes, you bring in this, you know, world-encompassing idea or a mythic, yeah.
I would say, Roger, that, you know, some of these cultural symbols, like this Vishwarupam of Durga, so many times, I am not a religious person myself, but the face of Durga floating on water, it is such a powerful image of things which are getting lost. Things will probably again reappear in another form. So these things come normally to me, because as I told you, I don't plan the story myself. But in case of Sundar Potua, this Navagunjar plot, it's a very interesting thing. It is not conscious. But Navagunjar is something which is this particular form. You normally don't see. It's a very rare form of Vishnu.
It's a very rare form of Vishnu, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yes. It remained somewhere in my mind when I actually went to the village and saw this. So towards the end, I felt this is the most befitting, you know, present or the gift which Sundar Potua can give to his beloved. So it has inside it. It is probably more conscious.
And it lifts the story to a totally different level, that scene, that when he's thinking about the colors and the description of Vishnu's chimeric form, Navagunjar form. It's very rare. I think I've seen a statue of that somewhere in Odisha, if I remember clearly, but I think it's very, it's not there in any other part of India, I guess. Yes.
It's really wonderful. You see the painters, scroll painters doing this at home with all the natural colors. And the kind of devotion with which they do it, it is wonderful. It makes you aware of the third dimension of your own existence. What art can do to life.
Exactly. And it comes out so powerfully in your story, like how the world is changing and it's becoming commercial, and Sundar Patua is he's becoming so depressed because of all of it. So it's a wonderful book. I think we have to, we are completely out of time. Do get a copy of A Day in the Life of Mangaltaram. It's a fantastic book. It's available on Amazon and your local bookstores. Read Anitadi's other books. Mahanadi is coming out from Niyogi. It's a translation of a major work about Mahanadi River of Odisha. And be safe and good night. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Rajesh. Thank you.
Thank you, Anitadi.